Okay, here we go. John Gonder 4. CS92A, Fall 24, CCNA, and Lecture 0001101. And you know in hexadecimal it is 0x0 delta. Well, I did not yet put up any extra stuff for you for IP version 4, IP version 6. I will get to that later this week. I'm going to talk about this new Module 14 TCP UDP Layer 4, which has no place in Cisco CCNA, in a sense, because we're concerned with Layer 3 and on down. But anyway, we'll get there. Last part of the semester, plan ahead. Duh. And if you got some catching up to do, make sure to catch up. We're following on our agenda here. This week we're doing 14, next week we're doing 15. And in the background, we're going to continue to do IP version 4 and version 6. It's a little late in the day and I haven't had dinner yet. But I wanted to get this out and get it to you today. Just an example. So let's say I have the screenshot assignment. I'm supposed to look at the banner login that was captured with Wireshark, PCAPNG. I'm supposed to locate the server hello and locate the TLS version and the cipher suites used. Now, in Cisco speak, we call that the transform set, the cipher suite that's used between the browser and the server. So here actually is that particular PCAP, and I'm looking at it with the new default profile. And if I'm looking to filter for TLS, and I'm seeing, okay, here's starting with layer 3, layer 4, got application data going on. And if I follow the TCP stream for this particular connection, I can see the SYN, SYNAC, and ACK that starts out at TCP layer 4, which we're going to talk about more in a second. And then there's, now that we've established a layer 1, 2, 3 pipeline to the other side, now layer 4, the client application, sends a hello, TLS version 1.3, and then we get an acknowledgement, and then we get a server hello, change cipher, and this is the kind of stuff I'm supposed to be looking for in this job. I'm supposed to find the server hello, TLS version, cipher suite, and then take a screenshot of that. So here is my server hello. I'm going to move that up, take a look here, server hello. Let me see, here's my diagram, layer 2, layer 3, layer 4, transmission control protocol. And then TLS is what's being carried. And if I look over here, I can see TLS version 1.2, version 1.3. That's an interesting anomaly that we might investigate more if I'm making a report on this. But I can see that, okay, here's the session ID, and here's the cipher suite or transform set that's going to be being used for this communication. Server hello, here's my packet, server client hello, server hello, here's my packet, here's my cipher suite. And is there anything that I'm interested in over here on the left? Not really. So I'm going to pull this in a little bit so that when I take a screenshot, I've got everything that I've been asked for to talk about and to demonstrate. Say, for instance, that we're able to get from one side to the other at layer 3, layer 2, layer 1, our Cisco layers, but I'm not able to log in. Well, this actually was a problem for COPCCD a few years ago when they went to Windows 7, and the transform sets that were acceptable to Windows 7 were not compatible with the transform sets that were programmed into the Banner server, and nobody could log in. Well, this is the kind of stuff we do in the Wireshark class. This is how you start to zoom in what is actually being said at the packet level, because the packets don't lie. Okay, I've got TCP, SYN, SYNAC, ACK. We've got a pipeline going, but I can't log in. Well, the reason was because the set of transforms that were acceptable to the client. Let's look at the client here. I'm going to digress just for a second here. Here is what the client sent to the server and said, "Hi, hey, how you doing? By the way, look, we got to have some cipher suites, so I've got 21 I'm willing and able to do in my order of preference. I'd really like to have this one, but if you really want to do that, all right, whatever." And then the server takes that and looks at its configuration and says, "Okay, well, they told me that this server is going to be able to do these cipher suites. So where's my first match? Where's my first match?" And that's what the server hello sends back. So that's what we're looking for. So if we weren't able to connect, we would look to see what was the client saying it could do. And then was there something that the server was saying, "Okay, I could do this out of your list." Or was it sending back and saying, "No, I don't have any of those in my list." So there we go. I got my picture. But the point I was about to make was that you saw how easy that was. If what I had done was take a picture of the whole thing and then made it 800, that's what it would look like. Instead, when I zero in on what I'm supposed to be supplying, the information that we're supposed to be looking at and what's useful to us in solving the problem, that's what it looks like 800 wide. Okay, so let's get on. Let's jump on module 14. So up in Cisco, we're going to be talking about the transport layer, layer 4. And the two important protocols that we use in layer 4, TCP and UDP. And right off the bat, I'm just going to tell you, everything we learn about TCP is basically like sending a letter return receipt requested. We're really going to know what's going on with this transmission. UDP, that's like a postcard. I put it in the mail. You get it, you don't. I don't know. I don't care. But it's really fast. There's no overhead. So it's really useful for things like, say, for instance, this video, because the packets that are going out to you in this video are forming a new entire new picture every 1/30th of a second. So if we're missing a couple of packets, would we use TCP where I get a return receipt requested, I get an acknowledgement, and then if something's missing, I try to retransmit it in the middle of everything else going on? No, because it's already too late to use that information in that packet. Same thing with voice over IP, or any kind of streaming application, anything that is time dependent. TCP is really good because we can know for sure you got it. And that's where, as you go in here, you start to see, well, DNS, I'm not sure if it talks about it in here, DNS, domain name services, well, that's a hierarchical thing, isn't it? I've got a DNS that's close to me, and I can ask, okay, I want to go to CNN.com, what's the IP address? And I get that IP address, I put it in my browser, and there we go, I'm at CNN. But where did he get his information? Now, he really doesn't care about me, so our conversation, my DNS request to my first layer there is, that's UDP. I'm sending a postcard, maybe he got it, maybe he didn't, I'll wait a little bit. If I didn't hear anything from him, I'll send it again. Low overhead. He needs to get good information from the top layer of DNS servers. They communicate with TCP, meaning I sense a packet, gets an acknowledgement. It actually got there. It didn't get mashed. UPS didn't leave it on the porch in the rain. Thanks. So some applications even make use of both TCP and UDP, depending upon what the need is. Okay, so here in the curriculum overview, why do we need layer four? It's because whatever's coming down from the application gets packaged up, and layer three is a best effort, remember? He's mostly worried about, okay, I got a package from this guy, and I want to put a street address and a zip code on it, and I want to see that it gets there, do my best effort, you know, but I've got no way of knowing if it actually got there or not. And so at layer four, we can have things like TCP, Transmission Control Protocol, which provides us more responsibilities, more flexibility, and more accountability by keeping track of what's going on. And then also remember, we can have many things going on at the same time. So how do we manage that? There is one network interface card here. So that's where the idea of having ports, which correspond to, it's like a room in this building at this address, this IP address, and different things are happening in different rooms, and that's part of the package inside the packaging that layer three gets. Out on the Ethernet, inside layer two and layer three, and inside is layer four. Well, part of the packaging at layer four, TCP, UDP, QUIC, tells us, well, layers five, six, and seven, what application made this stuff? A port number. And then, who are we talking to at the other end? What is their cubicle number? What is their room number in the building at that IP address? So that's how it's taken care of once it gets to that machine at the end, and that package is sent up to layer four. Layer four opens up and says, okay, well, who am I giving this to? Which of these guys, which of these departments, browser, email, you know, whatever, you know, games, whatever, who am I giving this to? Same thing, packaging it up, sends it back to the source computer. Computer takes it in, layer three, hands it up to layer four. Layer four opens it up and says, all right, well, now who generated, who's talking this? Who's having this conversation here? That's the port it came from, and who's it destined for here in my building? Browser? Oh, and even you got different web pages. Each web page is going to have its own port number because it's a different conversation. This port number here is my conversation with Cisco. This port number here is my conversation with the Canvas application. Both with the same browser, two different windows. If I looked inside the packets coming in and out of this interface, I would see at layer four that difference. This is going to one port number at one IP address, coming back to my address, but a different port number that corresponds to this window. So that's where those packets and that information, those pictures, that text is going to go. Different port number here. Same browser, same IP address, same port going out of here. Going to Cisco's IP address and probably port 443, since this is HTTPS. Coming back to me my one way out of here. Comes up layer three, opens up. Layer four says, oh, okay, that's the page for Canvas. That's where we're sending that info. So that's what's going on here. Different applications. And notice, like I was talking about here, DNS is shown as using TCP for some things, talking among the higher layers of DNS, the hierarchy that really needs to know for sure that the updated DNS information has been received properly. And UDP, where they're talking to us and they don't care. Trivial file transport protocol, like we use for saving and for transmitting configurations for our routers and switches, if we're not using it very securely, uses UDP. And then goes to layer three, layer two, layer one. There you go. So, provides a number of things. Tracks the data segments and keeps track of was there an acknowledgement from the other end. And if the application can support it, then sends information to the application saying, hey, they didn't get this packet. You need to give me that information one more time and we'll send it again and see if they got it. Acknowledging received data, retransmitting unacknowledged data after a certain amount of time. Keeping things in sequence that might arrive in the wrong order, because out on the internet, there's a lot of different ways to get from A to B. And some are a few milliseconds later, so packets don't necessarily come in order, page one, page two, page three of the original data, and it needs to be reordered somewhere along the line, right? So, that's what's going on, voice over IP, DNS, fast, low overhead, no acknowledgments, doesn't resend lost data, delivers data as it arrives, UDP. I put it out there. Did you get it? I don't care. I'm not even going to ask. TCP. Send it out there. Did you get it? Yes, I got yours. There's more to that, but at each layer here, then there's going to be some check your understanding. So one of the things we have this week is a number of checks as we go through module 14. First one here, transportation of data. Then an overview of TCP. What are the features? What does the header look like? So in this stream of ones and zeros, at what point in this stream is the beginning and ending of the source port, right? The room number that's going to get that sent us to us, and then at what point in the data stream, at what offset, do we start the definition port, the destination port, the guy who's getting it at the other end, and is there a sequence number for this data, an acknowledgement number, What window size? Because I let people know I've got a buffer here when data comes at layer four. The application has to be responsible for taking that, and they're not always that responsible. So sometimes that window, and this is a problem we see and we address in the Wireshark class, because we don't really know at layer three and below. The switch doesn't know the data came in, it went to layer four. I don't know, I don't care. But at some point, if that buffer is full, then communication stops. I send a Windows Zero message, zero window message. Don't send me any more data until Joe comes and picks this stuff up off my desk here. I got no more room. A checksum. So at this point, we run a check to see did any bits get made one or zero that were zero or one on the way over here. Is this really urgent, rather than wait until we have enough data to form one full packet before sending that out? For instance, is it an urgent bit? push bit? Do I want to try to send stuff as quickly as possible and get it to the server or get it to the browser without doing any of the kind of waiting that I might normally do? Is, oh yeah, data's coming down. When I got a full box, then I'll package it up and give it to layer three. Or, oh wait, no, this is the last bit of a file, so it's never going to be a full box, so you need to send it like it is. So there's options and functions available at layer four, especially in TCP, that are far beyond the functions available in just layer three. Is, yeah, I sent the packet, and I can see that we've got good connectivity to the other end. Got layer two, layer one. Yeah, we're good to go. And that's all I know, and that's all I care. Well, so how does this begin? For TCP, we've got a three-way handshake. We'll look at that in a second here. Meaning, layer four creates a packet that says, I would like to synchronize with you. And if the other side that receives that packet is capable and willing to do that, has enough resources, and maybe the destination port goes to an application that's actually running, then it will send an acknowledgement. I received your request to sync, but also I'm ready to sync with you. So we get a SYNACK. SYNACK, and then I acknowledge, okay, yeah, I got your SYN. So now we have a pipeline established at layer four, and we can tell our upper layers that they can start sending us data that we'll package up for layer three. So this provides reliability and then also flow control. We talked about windows. I send a window size that says how much data I can accept. There are a number of different options that TCP has, and to see whether or not the way I'm programmed and the options that I'm willing, able, and prefer to do are compatible with the options that the server on the other end at layer four is willing, able, and would desire to do, that's a negotiation that happens during that three-way handshake. So, flow control is something that then is able to be taken care of with those capabilities of layer four TCP. And then again, at each stage here, we've got another check your understanding. Then, with regard to UDP, well, low overhead versus reliability. We talked about that. Yeah, we put it in the mail and sent it to you, and I don't know if you got it, and I don't care. But it's fast. There's no back and forth. Same thing. We can reorder bits or not. Connectionless and unreliable. TCP, reliable and connection-oriented. Words you'll see with regard to the kinds of questions that Cisco might have for layer four and up. Not an in-depth understanding, and certainly not any kind of understanding that would allow you to do any serious troubleshooting or repair to problems that occur above layer three. Similarly, there are source and destination port numbers, right? We've got a DNS application process that's running here. It has a port number attached to it because it has its own room in my building at this IP address. And there is a destination port number for UDP at the other end. There certainly is no window size, there's no acknowledgments, there's no tracking of any kind. So say DNS, my source port, my ephemeral port of 49.152 assigned to this question, I'm sending to port 53 to the DNS server. And again, there's a check your understanding of UDP information. And at the end, there's a module quiz. There's a packet tracer here. And I'm going to open this PDF, but in reality, there's no assessment items here. This is just a packet tracer that utilizes that feature that you've seen very early on in the packet tracer learning videos that first few weeks, that you can have it at the logical level, let you see packets moving through a network, and you can look one at a time at what's inside. Wireshark is so much better than that. So that's why the last thing for us here after the checks and after the module quiz is to take a couple of screenshots of Wireshark at particular aspects of layer 4 so you can really see what these look like in operation and why it's important to be able to look easily and diagnose inside the packet above layer 3, because the packets don't lie. So there's a module quiz, overall module quiz for you to do. But beyond that, have fun with the packet tracer activity if you want to do that. But let me show you what we've got for Wireshark. So module 14 has that 14.17, check your understanding to screenshot, 2.5, 3.5, 4.5, 5.6, 6.8, and 7.5. And then the module quiz. So I've got them set up here in two groups of three for the quick checks and then separately for the module quiz. So no deliverable for that packet tracer. Just have fun with that if you would like. The more time you have with packet tracer and its various idiosyncrasies, the easier it'll be for you to do the things with packet tracer that are exams at the end of the semester. So, but there's no assessment items to complete, so there's nothing to report. So now we're seeing a more complete picture of the OSI model. We're seeing layer one, physical layer, could be a cable, could be pigeons, could be lasers, whatever. Logical link control, which has capabilities of interfacing with various physical layers, and then interfacing with a network layer. The network layer, which gives us that routing information, deals with fragmentation to get through a smaller pipeline, operates in units of packets, and you can see by this color that the routing protocols that we'll talk about a little bit later all use layer 3, and there's no higher layer aspect of them. When we start to get into transport layer, that's where for UDP or TCP or TCP and UDP, there are application layer, some of which have a presentation or session layer, a login to an application server, or not, but they use one or the other of these transport layer, UDP, short and quick, TCP, connection-oriented and reliable, to take care of that process of managing the connection and managing the packet delivery. So we're going to look at two different Wireshark trace files at layer 4, and we're going to find some information and screenshot that, as I'm going to show you. So there's a screenshot for UDP and a screenshot for TCP as we highlight some of the major characteristics of each of those layer 4 protocols. So, like I said, now you're starting to see the rest of the OSI model that really is not dealt with at the Cisco layer. The troubleshooting and analysis of all the kinds of things that can go wrong in a complex environment of multiple operating systems and multiple applications and multiple ways of doing business. So that's why I wrote the CAS 76 Wireshark class, and that's why it is so important. So these trace files are going to be there in the week 13 documentation there in Playbook. So we're going to look at this trace file, and we're going to use the new default profile that you have already. We're going to filter for domain name server requests and replies, and we're going to look at this one packet one. We're going to expand that and explore that. And then we're going to take a screenshot of some of the aspects of it, specifically the time to live. In part because I want to emphasize to you the contrast between time to live, like we talked about in terms of a ping or a trace route, or that you see a time to live at layer 3, versus time to live with regard to other protocols. So let's go there and take a look at it. So you should already have this presentation of panes. Here's the list of, I'm going to get rid of this filter, this list of packets. And then this is the diagram of the structure of the packet. And then here are all of the different fields, and in general, their values, the information that's contained at each point in this data stream. If for some reason you don't see this, then that's where we go to preferences, Wireshark preferences. And with regard to the layout, we're choosing this layout. The first pane is the packet list. The second pane is the diagram. And the third is the packet details, so that we can see that. We can move this over a little bit if we're looking here. If we're highlighting something here, it's going to be highlighted over here. We can see the structure. We can see the structure. Inside the Ethernet is, what are we carrying in here? We're carrying IP version 4. That's the outsidemost label on that package. Okay, well, let's open that package a little bit, and we see IP version 4. It's version 4. There's a header. How long is it? What's the ID number of this packet? Is this a fragment of something? No. Time to live. How many hops can this go on the internet before a router says, dude, your packet died, just like in traceroute, right? That's time to live at IP layer. How many hops on the internet can we go before we have to die? What are we carrying inside this wrapper? Well, source and destination IP addresses, but inside this wrapper, if we take this next layer off, we're going to see TCP at layer 4. Well, what was the source port of this information? What's the destination port of this information at this destination IP address? What's the sequence number and acknowledgement number that we're assigning to this stream to keep track? And those sequence numbers and acknowledgement numbers move and change, and that's one of the things we look very deeply into in the Wireshark class, because that's how we start to find problems with the transmission and understanding of information at higher layers. There's a checksum. We did a check on this data, and we did or we didn't see that any bits got mashed. No bits were mashed in the transmitting of this data. And then what's actually inside this TCP package? Well, here's our data. Now, it's not broken down any farther than that, because here we're talking about DNS. I'm going to filter for DNS. And I see here's a query, and over here on the left-hand side with those two arrows, Wireshark shows me that there's a relationship between here. Well, it's a query and a response. And we can also look and see what the actual query ID number was, and that they match up. Source IP, destination IP, destination port 53, the DNS server, from that guy to this device, to port 4372, which is the port assigned to this particular conversation for this question and response. So what are we looking for in this? Well, we're looking for time to live, but we're also looking for the other aspects of this particular UDP packet. So inside this UDP packet is this payload, which is a domain name system, transaction ID. Are there any flags that are set that say how this should be interpreted and dealt with? Are there questions? Are there answers? Well, we're looking at the response. So that's why a DNS response reiterates what the question was and then gives its answer. And then is there anything else going on? Sometimes there's more information involved there. If I move over here to look at it more granularly with the flags, I've right-clicked on this and I've said expand all. So at the UDP layer 4, we've got a source destination port. How long is it? The checksum wasn't verified. Do we have any timestamps? And then inside is domain system portion of it. In this case, it's a response. And so the flags, yeah, this flag is on, meaning that this is a response. And there is recursion desired, recursion available for looking up information. There's a question in here. There's an answer in here. Here's what the query was. And here's what the answers are. Sometimes there's more than one. CNN has more than one server. Wireshark also includes a link here to the original question. And the question itself has a link to the response. So it's Wireshark makes it easy for us to move back and forth. And notice the time here. This is the delta time between this query and this response, no matter how many other packets were received in between here. Wireshark knows that these two are related and shows us the time delay. Another one of the things that we want to look at when we're doing more deep analysis and deep troubleshooting, is that server slow? Do we not get to the website we were looking for because the DNS server was slow in responding, that the browser gave up waiting for that answer? One of the kinds of things we diagnose with Wireshark. Well, now here's the last thing, time to live. 15 hours, 48 minutes, and 21 seconds. Really? Well, what that means, at this layer, Maharishi used to say, truth is different at different layers of consciousness. At layer 3, time to live means how many hops we can go out there between routers. Inside that package is this information, and it says you can depend upon this information to be accurate. You can put it in your DNS cache and use it over and over again for 15 hours, 48 minutes, and 21 seconds. Then you have to ask me again to see if that has changed. That's the time to live for DNS. That's the DNS time to live. It's not the layer 3 time to live. It's upper layer time to live. Well, I think I might like to try to squish this up a little bit, since what I'm being asked for is time to live. And there's my response. Here's my stuff. I might squish this in a little bit because I really don't care about what's out there. And I'm going to take a good screenshot here that allows me then to highlight. I might actually even want to make that pink because I kind of like that. Take it again. And I can see that's 900 pixels wide. So when I make it 800, that's still pretty good. And if what I'm going to do is annotate this a little bit, highlight that time to live, highlight this is a response, here was the query, here was the answer, UDP sends it to me, no TCP handshake, no acknowledgments, sent it to me. If I got it, great. If I didn't get it, he doesn't care. I'll ask again. If I didn't get it within a certain timer time. Okay, UDP. Cool. Let's look at TCP. Well, there's more going on with TCP. We're going to look at this file. We're going to, again, use that standard profile. We're going to look for the three-way handshake. And we're going to look for the TCP options, and that's what we want to screenshot. We're also going to look at some of the information that we get, like the round trip time, look at the window size, and look at the acknowledgments place in a TCP packet. Okay, I opened that up. Why am I not seeing anything? Well, I've still got my same filter on before. I got to turn that off and start to take a look at this. Over here, bottom right, I'm using my default profile. I can see here that there's 15 packets in this small file. I can see that I've got TCP, SYN, SYNACK, and ACK. The three-way handshake where TCP on one side, 192.168.0.26 says, I would like to synchronize with you 13.226.219.114 at port 80. And then 13 sends back from port 80 to port 54846, an ephemeral port assigned to this conversation on this computer. Oh, I acknowledge you sent me a SYN request. Furthermore, there's somebody alive up there at port 80, and so we have sufficient resources, and I have, if you look at this more closely, which we will in the Wireshark class, there's more going on here. Like in this first process between SYN and SYNACK, he had to say, okay, well, I need to check and see, do I have enough memory available here that I can create a bucket to receive stuff, and how big will that be? How much do I want to assign to that? How much memory? And then do I have enough memory to create a bucket to send things that come down from the application while I'm getting them ready to get out on the wire? So there's machinery going on there at layer 4. That then if it's all successful, we said, yeah, okay, well, I'm all ready to go here, and I can synchronize with you. Okay, cool. That comes back across, and now 26 says, okay, cool, I acknowledge that. And now they can each let their applications know we've got a pipeline, and now we're ready for a communication. And then here we get a GET request from the web browser. And then we get an acknowledgement of that request at layer 4 from the other side. And again, here is some of the stuff that we look at in Wireshark is like, well, okay, so I got there, but it's kind of slow. Well, why is it slow? Is it the network? Is it the operating system? Is it the computer? Is it the application? Is it access to a data server at the back end? What's going on? Well, that's where the packets don't lie, when we can look down very deeply into them and see. Well, first of all, what's the round trip time? How would we know that this is not slow, because the network itself is slow and the routers between here and there are slow and bogged down? Well, this SYN went out. We're capturing at the browser computer. 20 milliseconds later, we got the SYN ACK. So a packet went to the other end. There was a teeny bit of think time on that operating system. Then a packet was created and sent back to us, and we received it all in 20 milliseconds. That's a very acceptable time frame. If this was 300 milliseconds, and every time we send a packet, we had to wait another 300 milliseconds for an acknowledgement, and it took another 300 milliseconds for the next packet to get over there, then we'd start to say, well, we've got a network problem here. I'm taking you into some of the processes we do in troubleshooting things in the Wireshark class. Now we get a GET request, and then I get an acknowledgement. Again, what it was 25 milliseconds between this request and this acknowledgement. Is this any data? No, this is just an acknowledgement from the operating system at layer 4 that, yeah, I got your package, and I gave it to him. So we're not seeing any data. If I look inside here, what do I see? It's 66 bytes. There's no data. It's just like, yeah, I got it. Well, what happens next? Well, then we start to get some data. We start to get data. And so there's a point in time when we start to see data and acknowledgments from the other side. If what we see is a long delay between getting the acknowledgments from the operating system and starting to actually get something useful from the application, then we know what? They got a problem. Maybe the application is overloaded. Maybe there's not enough CPU time allocated to that application. It's run out of RAM. It's trying to access an external hard drive for storage, and that's slow. We can't necessarily know everything that's going on, but we can start to narrow down where our problems are and start to see. Is it the network? No, it's not. Is it nobody's home? No, we got a SYN ACK and ACK. Somebody's home at port 80, and we made a request, and we got an acknowledgement again in QuickTime. And we started to get stuff. So stuff is really going on here. Well, the other thing we wanted to do was start to look more deeply at the TCP options, because once you've read through the information in the curriculum, you'll start to see there's a lot of things that TCP can do for us. Okay, so let's see. Here's the SYN packet. It's an Ethernet packet from one MAC address to another MAC address, and inside that Ethernet packet is IP version 4. Okay, we got IP version 4. There's a time to live on the internet, and inside we're carrying TCP layer 4, and it's from a IP address here to an IP address there. And then at TCP 4, we've got a source port locally, a destination port. That's going to be a web server. We got some flags. We got a window size we're starting to advertise. I'm ready to go. So I've allocated a bucket here, 65,535. We got a checksum, and then we got TCP options. So what are the TCP options? Let's look more closely into that. Well, here's our flags, and the flags are 1. This is a SYN packet. I want to synchronize with you. What are the options? Well, I can take a maximum segment size. I can manipulate a maximum segment size of 1460 bytes. So my MSS value is 1460. Now, because the space available for setting a window size is fixed in terms of number of bits, and there's a lot more RAM available than there used to be when this was first created, a couple other bits were assigned to say, well, okay, it says like 65,535, it says like whatever. Here's a multiplier. So whatever you see there, you multiply it by this to get the actual amount of size of my bucket. Now, we're going to do timestamps. I want to do timestamps, and here's an initial timestamp value. I also am willing to, and I would like to do, selective acknowledgments. So rather than my send you one packet and then you acknowledge that and then I send you another packet, so we've got like what, four round trip times associated with getting 1460 bytes across. What if I send you a stream no more than the size of the window you tell me, the size of your bucket, but I can send you all kinds of stuff unacknowledged, and then you can send me one acknowledgement that covers that whole stream. Selective acknowledgements. That's again another big thing that we go into, because you know, when good protocols go bad, then you start to look inside the packets and say, well, what are they actually saying to each other deep inside the packet? Because the packet doesn't lie. Timestamps, etc. Okay, so I've said what I like. Here's packet 2, SYNAC from the other side. Okay. Ethernet, IP version 4 inside, time to live 238. That guy said a time to live. We could bounce this stuff around the internet for quite a while. His source, my destination. Inside is TCP, his source port 80, his web server, the destination port 54846, the ephemeral port number assigned to my browser window. We don't have any sequence acknowledge numbers yet because what? We're still setting the pipeline up, so we haven't started a data stream. But we start it at a number of one, and again, that's one further aspect that we'll look at far more closely in the Wireshark class. Flags, he's got a window size, and he's got options. So let's take a look at that. Okay, so here's his options. It's an acknowledgement, and it's a SYN. So SYN, ACK. Both these flags are set to indicate what kind of packet this is. Well, what does he say he can do? Well, he can do 1440. Now, he does selective acknowledgments, and he does timestamps. So now that we've come to an agreement here, I can acknowledge that, and in my options, I'm going to say, okay, well, sounds good. I wanted 1460. You said 1440, so we'll just go with 1440. So here's the SYN. SYNAC, got my round trip time. Acknowledgement, we've come to an agreement with our TCP options, selective acknowledgements, maximum segment size, etc. We like long walks on the beach. You know, we don't put sugar in our coffee. And now we're ready to let our upper layers know we got a pipeline to the other side. We can start sending requests, get acknowledgements, we can start getting data. That's TCP. Well, what do I want? I want to look at the TCP options of the SYN packet. So let's go back here and we'll find there's my SYN packet. Here we go. Here's the TCP options section. It gets highlighted over here. I'm going to scroll that up, make sure that it's expanded so we can see maximum segment size. I might move this up further. So, bam, there we go. I can see maximum segment size, my multiplier, my timestamps, my selective acknowledgments. That's the stuff I'm interested in, so I'm going to narrow this up a little bit before I take my screenshot. And that's 880, so when I make it 800, that's pretty good. And then the same thing when I go and I highlight that a little bit. Okay, so we got SAC, and we're doing timestamps, and I've got my maximum segment size that I'm asking for here in the SIN packet is 1460. And there we go. Here's my SIN packet. And that looks pretty good. So those are the two screenshots for our investigation of some of the details inside a UDP packet and a TCP handshake in the packet. And some of the things that we can see, round trip time. What are the window sizes that are being advertised? For instance, if the window size is really small, meaning there's not a lot of resources available on one side, well, we don't necessarily then get a lot of data being transmitted very quickly. Because what? Even though we can do selective acknowledgments and we can shovel this stuff down the hole, if the other guy can't accept that into his bucket because of something, he didn't have enough RAM, he couldn't make a big bucket, and you know, the guy upstairs is not picking it up very quickly, and so he keeps having to make his window size very small, maybe only two or three packets at a time. Again, we start to see inside the packet, the packets don't lie. They tell us what's really going on and why we're maybe able to be fast, maybe not so fast. We can operate one way, maybe we'd like to operate a different way, but the other side doesn't agree. We'd like to do selective acknowledgments, but the server is old and doesn't know how to do acknowledgments, or they misconfigured that. This is where we see those contrary opinions on things from one side to the other inside the packet. So that's very cool. And that's why my handle out there is packet level, because that's where the truth comes out. When you start to look very deeply inside the packet, at packet level, packets don't lie. Okay, so what's the bottom line? Well, last part of the semester, so plan ahead. You want to give yourself plenty of time to think about and work out, and we'll be setting up and having available for you practice sessions for the final exams and the skills assessment very soon. We're coming on following our agenda, and there's several things to do. There's the little teeny little checks, and then there's the module quiz, and then our two screenshots that we looked at, and gaining a good understanding, well, at least a beginning of an understanding of the kind of granular approach to troubleshooting that we have available to us when we can look inside the packet at a very deep layer and see, what are these guys actually saying? What is the actual correspondence that's going on at that bit level inside the lowest levels of the upper layers of the protocol? So there you go. That is what's going on. Module 4, and again, like I said, there's not a lot in the Cisco CCNA that relates to this kind of understanding of what's going on there, the kind of understanding that gives you that troubleshooting capability at upper layers. But an understanding that those things exist is all you need here for this class. Enjoy. We'll see you on the net.